Welcome back to UC 520. As I promised, we are going to start learning about CMake language. And this is new to in this semester. I just added it and I'm very excited about it. CMake language is one of the most popular build generator tools that you can learn. And if you know the language and you know how to create complex systems using CMake, you're going to have really higher advantage over a lot of applicants when you apply for any embedded system position. Now, before getting it started, as a reminder, we have a midterm exam on Saturday. It is going to be in person. There would be 20 to 30 multiple choice question on paper, and it would be just all the topics that we covered from the beginning of the semester, basically C programming, C++ programming concepts, introduction to ARM, and also basic concepts that we covered in the interrupt discussion. And then after the 30 minutes of just taking the quiz, you have the rest of the time to work on your midterm project. And the setup is I'm going to give you a programming assignment that you have to complete. It's similar to your exorcism projects, with the difference that it's going to run on one of the development boards that we have, either on the Kirio board or on Raspberry Pi Pico. I'm going to focus mostly on the programming aspects of the project instead of just asking you to create firmware and wrestle with the rest of the tools. But you should be able to at least complete the exam, basically the programming assignment, during the given time. Now, you might ask, why am I doing this? The reason is this will help you to get into the habit of doing, word is doing the competitive programming. So I'm going through a couple of interviews these days, and some of the companies actually ask me to go and complete some programming exercise or programming exams or questions with a very short amount of time. So you have to read the program, just get the exam, just complete it, and then just submit and go to the next one. So it's a good practice to be able to become a fast thinker and fast problem solver. The goal is not to just torture you and make you nervous. The goal is to help you get into the mindset of writing competitive coding. Basically, write as fast as you can, think as fast as you can, and solve the problem and go to the next step. So that's our plan for Saturday. Okay, now let's get into our today's topic, which is the CMake language. So as a credit, the information in these slides are coming from these resources. The first one is Modern CMake for C++, and the other one is from this really good workshop that you can find online from this group. They have a set of good instructions, simple instructions that you can just learn and follow. And also, they have good exercises that you can actually look into you or finish it yourself. So I'm in the process of adding some of these exercises, not these, but some other ones also, well, to as a programming exercise to you guys, so you can actually practice CMake programming. But I'm still in the process of that, so I might have it ready by 1 or 2 days. Okay, let's motivate the idea. What is CMake and why should you care? So if you have done any C programming, C, C++ programming, you know that the process of converting your code from a text-based code into a binary executable is kind of a tedious process. Unless your program is just only one file and you only need to run a single compiler command, you're going to have a hard time managing your build system. Basically, if you have a Imagine if you have a system that requires, it has more than thousands of files that you need to build and link and compile. You can imagine how tedious the work can become. So you have done some similar activities in the couple of labs ago. Basically, I was asking you to read these files and then compile them into an object file and then link them at the end. So basically, for three files, you had to run three commands or four commands. Three for compiling the files into object file, the last command to link them together so it would become an executable that you can run. Now imagine if you have 1,000 of those, how can you manage that? So one way is you can just write everything from scratch using a compiler command, basically writing all your compiler commands by hand and running them one at a time. Now that would be problematic for a couple of reasons. The first one is, what if some of the file names change? What if some files gets removed and so on? That's one problem. Another problem is when you execute any compiler command, compiler job is to just execute the command you give it. It doesn't check if the program is already built or the object file exists. The compiler does not do that. Now, if you have thousands of these files, you want to generate and build them each time, it's going to sometimes take a long time to do. And if you have done any programming, you know that you need to build and check your program frequently to check if it's actually doing what it is supposed to do. So imagine if you have to build all those 1,000 files each time you run your program. So that would be problematic. So your build process is going to be very slow. So to solve this problem, people have come up with the idea of the build tools. So one of those build tools is GNU Make. So it was created during the GNU project in 1980s. And the idea was that you could provide commands to the make, basically writing this make, GNU Make syntax, syntaxes, and let the make take care of the build process. Basically telling the make, okay, look for all the .cpp files in my project and then build them. Or you could say, these are the compiler flags that I want to apply for these set of files, and those are the compiler flags that I want to apply to those set of files. You could provide arguments to the make. You could say, if I provide make clean, basically an argument to make, then clean up all the artifacts that was generated by make. If I provide make all run all the programs that they have, if I provide make just for example driver, just build the driver part of the project. You could provide dependencies to these files. You could say, I have this a.cpp, which depends on the bf90 and xf90. If any of those changes, build the acpp also. So you could create dependencies between the files and then let the make watch it and only build the things that changed and not build the whole thing. That improved the build process in that sense. Now, you might ask, okay, if make is that great, why we are not using make? The reason is make language, unfortunately, is kind of cryptic. And when you're writing cryptic, when you write a, you want to create a complex project using make, things can get really complicated very soon, especially if you have multiple subfolders and dependencies outside of your project and so on. So people came up with the idea of the CMake. So CMake is basically a generative tool, a generative build tool. So the name is build system generator. The idea is instead of CMake, you're writing make yourself, you're going to write a simpler syntax using CMake. And CMake is going to read your syntax and it's going to convert it into a native build tool language like make. So make is not the only build system that exists out there. There are other ones like Ninja and a few others, but make is the one that I'm just focusing here. So you can use CMake to generate codes like make file code syntax, and then use make to complete the build. So in that sense, CMake is not a build tool. It's build system generator. It's going to generate set of files and instructions that can be passed to a native build tool like make and then generate the output product. Now, CMake itself has a domain-specific language or DSL. So some languages are created for specific tasks, and CMake is one of them. So it's a domain-specific language. It doesn't have all the bells and whistles that you get from a like a generic language like a C or C++ or other languages. It's a specific for building system generators. It's going to generate get set of commands and generate what you ask for. So it's a very specific domain-specific language. So it's in that sense, the language sometimes seems a little bit weird when you learn it first, but after a while you get used to it, and then you can write complex systems with it. So when you create a CMake-based build system, these are the advantages that you're gonna have. The first one is it can bring your software closer to being platform and compiler agnostic. So the idea is, instead of you writing compiler specific commands, for example, instead of writing GCC or writing Clang commands, you can just use CMake commands, and then just provide CMake will translate your commands between the compilers. So that's one of the main benefits of CMake. So your CMake is going to be agnostic to the compiler and also the platform that you're going to use. By platform, I mean you can run it on Windows, you can run it on Linux, and so on. And it has a good support within the integrated development environments like IDEs. There is a good support for CMake in Microsoft Visual Studio. That's the big IDE that Microsoft provides for developing C, C++, C Sharp, and anything else they have. It has a good support in the, for example, JetBrains. They have this IDE called C Lion. So C Lion has a native support for CMake and a few other IDEs that are out there. And also, it automatically tracks and propagates the internal dependencies in your project. So dependencies are your biggest bottleneck and headache when you're creating big projects. I have this project that depends on another project, and that project depends on another project, and that project depends on another project. So dependencies, these are chain of dependencies that go on and on and on. So tracking those and taking care of those is kind of a big headache for any developer. So CMake helps you in that sense. And it has a really nice, well-maintained functionality for automating dependency detection. Basically, you can say, I depend, for example, on the Boost library, and it will take care of the rest of the dependencies for the Boost library in your design. You don't need to worry for the second stage or third stage dependencies in your build system. Okay, let's see a hello CMake example, and let's get familiar with CMake. Now, we are going to have this simple program, which is a hello world in C++. It's going to just print hello world using C++. It's a main function, just a standard std cout, just printing it and then exiting with the success. Now, when you create a CMake program, the first command that you want to use is the CMake minimum required. So remember, when you write a code, a CMake command or CMake syntax, everything is either a command or it's a comment. So it's either of those. So everything in CMake is a command, unless it's a comment that you want to just put there to let the user know this is a comment or why you're doing that. But in reality, everything else is a comment, command. So CMake minimum required is a command that we are running. It gets two, in here, it's getting two arguments. It actually gets more than two arguments. The first one's a version, and then this is a minimum version. Now, when you create a build system, the first thing you want to do is to make sure your build system is building what you're expecting to build. If the user is just cloning your GitHub repository on their machine, and their machine has different version of your build system, or it's something that is lower than the version that you're expecting to have, the result is going to be undefined. Basically, their build might even crash and not even finish. It might get into just generate a very weird messages that they might get confused and not figure out why it's wrong with it, what is wrong with it, or it might build something that is not intended to build. Basically, using the old features that you were not expecting to put into you don't want to put into this final result. So you want to minimize that, and that's done by this CMake minimum required. So you want to make sure Whoever is building your project, either yourself, your future self, or anybody who's just using your library, they're using the minimum required version for your CMake. Now, CMake has changed drastically from a CMake 2 to CMake 3. CMake 3.1 is considered modern CMake, and anything after CMake 3.1 is considered old CMake. So they have done a lot of changes and refactoring in the language. So we want to focus on modern CMake and not the old CMake. So if the system is not supporting the new CMake version, you will usually want to stop from the beginning and not move forward. Let's ask the user to update their system, then move on with the CMake, the version that you're targeting. So in any project that you create, this is the first line that you add in your CMake list.txt. Next one is the project. So any C++ project you create, it has a name. So the project name is provided here. So this project is called Hello. And that project is going to use these languages. So languages is another parameter, and the languages that you want to support are going to be listed after that. So CXX means C++ in CMake. Now, after that, you have your add executable. So when you finish your project, you want to create a final executable with your C or C++ program. That will be generated by this command, add executable. That executable is going to have a name, and all the files that are going to be compiled and linked together are going to be listed here. If you have only single files, you're going to list it here. If you have thousands of those, you're going to list it also here. So let's see this in example and in action. I'm going to just try to show you the actual CMake build process and then show them in the IDE, in the terminal. I highly recommend you also follow along if you can. If you have the computer at your disposal, you'll learn coding by writing code. By watching and listening, you might not get it or feel the how this thing works, and it's not gonna stay in your brain. Okay, I'm gonna remove the build folder here and remove the CMake that list. So the first thing I'm going to have is my source file. And that source file is going to be called hello.cpp. Then I'm going to have my CMake lists.txt. So at the root of your program, you need to have this file. And this file has to have this format, basically capital C, capital M, make lists. And then L has to be capital and then .txt. This is the text file, and that's the file name that you have to use. You cannot have any other file names or any other format. So the letter cases, this is very important to have the same exact letter cases in your file name. Okay. So let's put this here. If you want, okay, now what's the process for building the CMake? So the first step is, I think this is what you have used in the exorcism projects. Basically, you create a build folder and you go to the build folder and you run CMake dot dot. So this is just telling the CMake to go to the parent directory of this and look for the CMake list.txt. That's your root folder, and this is where to find the CMake list.txt. And then, if you don't provide any other arguments, CMake will assume that you're going to put all the artifacts that CMake is going to generate inside the current directory, which is the build directory. Now, CMake allows you to create in source builds. Basically, instead of putting them in the separate build folder, you can put them in the actual source folder here. Now, I don't recommend doing that, and this is not a good practice because CMake generates a lot of artifacts that you don't want to push into your or mix them with your source code. So that's highly discouraged. Definitely create an external build folder that you can delete or ignore with your git ignore and don't include it in your source file. So now let's see other ways to actually create or build the CMake. So CMake has a list of arguments that you can pass. So CMake comes with a tool called CLI, command line interface. So The command that we are writing basically is calling the CLI, command line interface of CMake. So the first thing I want to do is I want to say where to find my source directory. So the source directory is dash s, and it's going to be the current directory. So a single dot in Linux means the current directory. I'm going to put a slash in front of it to just emphasize that this is the current directory for you to remember, but I don't need to. I can just put a single dot. Also, you don't need to put a space. You can just put these, just concatenate them together. CMake figures out you mean that the source folder is here. But for clarity, I'm going to put a space here. Now, second is you have to you if you're you don't if I run this, it's going to generate all the artifacts inside my current source directory, which is going to mix it with my source. I don't want that. So you can provide dash b to tell the CMake to where to actually put the artifacts. I'm going to just ask CMake to put them in the build folder that I have. This is a build folder. Now, if I run this, you're going to see how many sources CMake is going to run. So if I run right now a tree, I only have these two files and nothing else. Now, if I run this command and run it, CMake finishes the configuration and generating the artifacts. Now, if I run tree now, you see how many artifacts it generated. This is just a very basic, simple Hello World program, but it's still, it generated all these artifacts that are used by CMake. And if you look at here, it also generated a make file. So if you look at the make file, it's always good to check and just, let's see, cd build, then make files. And this is a make file that was auto-generated by CMake. You see here, it generated a, this is a generic make file. So it has a lot of functions in it and so on. But yeah, this is a CMake that, this is a make file that was generated. Now, next step is building the actual project, right? This, if you look at here, there is no actual executable here. I need to create an executable. To create the executable, you have to build the project. So one step, one way is to just run the build tool itself. Basically run make, and make is going to read the make file here and generate your project, your executable. That's one way. Another way is you can use CMake itself. So you can run CMake dash dash build and path to your build folder. So my build folder is here. I'm going to run it, and it's going to build my C++ program and then link it and create an executable. So if I go to my build folder, this is my executable, hello. And if I run it, it's going to run my program. So that's how, this is a very simple CMake program that we just created here. It's a hello world to CMake. Okay, so that's what I mentioned. Now, CMake CLI comes with a handy help prompt that you can run. So if you run CMake dash dash help, it's going to show you all the options that you can get with the CLI. So if I type CMake dash dash help, it gives me all the options that exist. And if you look at this closely, you see dash S for explicitly specifying the source directory, dash B for explicitly specifying the build directory, and a bunch of other options. If you look closer here, there's a dash dash build that you can use to build a CMake generated project library tree. So this is actually building the project using your specified generator. Now, as I mentioned, CMake is a build tool generator. It's not a build tool itself. So to tell CMake or specify which kind of what is your target build tool? You use generators. And that is done by using dash capital G. So if you go up, you should see dash capital G to specify build system generator. So are you going to use Make? Are you going to use Ninja? Are you going to use code blocks for Ninja or any of the Eclipse support? There's a Sublime support and so on. So if you're using Windows, you might remember you're using, we asked you to use dash G min GW make files. So that's basically specifying your target make build system that you want to use. So that's your generator target. Okay. Okay, so that's what I specified. I mentioned dash S, dash B, and dash G for the generator support. Also with CMake, you can pass compiler commands, or you can specify the global variables that exist in CMake using dash D option. So dash D, with dash D, you can pass a variable to CMake, and CMake will apply it to your rest of the build system. So is it, if this is a CMake variable, it's going to have a CMake underscore in front of it. If it's a compiler command, it's going to have that the compiler name command in it. So in this one, we are telling the CMake that we are going to use Clang++. Well, let's give it a try, see if that works. So I'm going to remove my build folder, and I'm going to rebuild again. If you look at here, right now it's saying that the C++ compiler identification is GNU 940. Now I want to check if I use this, would that change it to Clang? So I'm going to remove build folder. And run this program. You see here, with this compiler flag that I passed to this, now this is just using Clang instead of using GNU. So with that, I changed the compiler flag, the target compiler from GNU to Clang. And this is going to use Clang to build the rest of the program. So this way, basically, this is agnostic to the compiler. I just provided the compiler that I want to use, and the rest of the thing is done by the CMake. Okay, so moving on. Now, CMake also provides more helpful information if you want to get it from the command line. So this one, helpful, if you run that, it is going to give you a lot of information. This is just list of the helps that exist in CMake. So you don't have to actually go through this when you're working with CMake. So CMake has a website. If you go to the CMake website, it's called cmake.org, and you go to getting started page, and they have a bunch of tutorials. They have a bunch of books that you can download. And there's a CMake reference document. If you click on that, they give you all the commands and variables and references that you need to work with CMake. So CMake comes with, I think, about 600 so commands, built-in commands, and about 127 variable commands, variables, global variables that you have to be, you need to be familiar to be able to use CMake. Usually you don't need to know all of them, but knowing, as if you know more, you can do more with the CMake. Okay. Now, if you want to, for example, look for a specific variable in CMake, you can provide its name and use dash dash help with the variable name, and it's going to just give you information about that specific variable. If I run that, it tells me CMake generator. You can use this to specify the generator that you're going to use for this, for example, Ninja or Unix make file. So when you put dash J and a string in front of it, that string gets stored in this CMake generator variable, and you can recall it, read it back. So that's some ways to get help from CMake command line. Now, when you're working with the CMake, you're actually going to have really powerful system to create and manage a tool chain system. So what is the idea? So CMake allows you to, besides building your project, it allows you to, besides building, it allows you to test your project. It allows you to deploy your project, package it into a final package that you want to give it to the user. It also allows you to install it for the user if you want. So in that sense, it's very powerful. So if you just pay attention here, the C stands for CMake time, the G stands for generation time, and the B is for build time. So you write your CMake.txt, and you have a bunch of source files in your project. Now, the cmake.txt, during the configuration, during the cmake time or configuration time, it's going to be parsed by cmake, and cmake is going to generate a bunch of scripts that can be used by your native build tool like GNU Make. And also at the same time, it's going to generate a bunch of source files for based on your source file that you have. So it's going to generate lots of artifacts based on just the cmake.txt that you wrote. And then during the build time, the build tool or the cmake wrapper is going to use this information for example, the make files and the generated preliminary files from your source file. It's going to use all of them to generate the final build target. Now, the term target, you're going to hear it a lot when you're learning about cmake. I'm going to come back to the targets again, but just to clarify, target is any executable or library that you create during cmake. So a library in C++ is a set of functions that you convert into a binary format, but they are not executable by themselves. They don't have a main function in them, but you can include them in your final result, and you can call the functions from those libraries and use them. So that's called library. Executable, the name suggests, right? It has a main function in it, and you can execute it and run it on your computer or your targeted development board. So that's a build target. Now you have options to test your program, basically run test, which is called CMake test, C test, to test the result. If you have done exorcism on your machine, you know that if you run CMake and then make after that, it builds your project, and also it executes the test. So you have that option with CMake. Also, you can package the CMake and then create a final package that you can provide to the user or even install it on user machine. So it's a complete tool chain system that you can use to manage a really large system, application. One moment, please. I'm gonna be back in 1 minute. Okay, I'm back. Okay, so now, as I mentioned, besides generating the executables, you can create libraries also with CMake. The command to create libraries is called add library. So each library has a name inside CMake, so that's your target name. And then a bunch of dependencies, basically all the files that should be converted into a library that you want to have in your project. So that's add library. Now, when you create libraries, you need to link them to your executable. Otherwise, there would be separated. They won't be connected to each other. So to link your libraries to your executable or link multiple libraries together, you use link libraries. So target is your object link library. So you provide that target that you want to link to, bunch of libraries to it, for example, your executable name, and then all the items or libraries that you want to link to it. So this would be your executable, for example. This would be your library one. This would be your library two. Now, each library can have specific access information. I'm not going to get into this too much, but for now, just know that this doesn't exist. The idea here is that you might have a library that is only should depend on your final target. Basically, it should be used only for your final target. So that would be private. You might have a library that is going to be used by everybody else who uses this target. So everybody else who uses this target are going to be also dependent on this item. So that would be public. And interface basically means that whoever is going to use this item, not this library, but this item, they have to interface with that library. So let's not get into that too much. You're going to practice with this enough and then you're going to get used to it. So again, as a recall, a target is basically the atomic, this is a basic atom in the CMake. This is either your executable or it's your library that you're creating using CMake. When you hear the term target, remember this. It's either your executable or it's your library that you're creating. That's target, basically. Now let's do an exercise here. So the requirements are this. Write a CMake list.txt to compile the source files from the message.cpp into a library. Do not specify the type of the library, shared or static or explicitly anything else. So when you create a library, you can specify the type of the library. We're not getting into those details yet. So two is add an executable from the hello world.cpp source file. And then lastly, link them together. So this is our message.hpp. This is our header file. It's using on line one, it's using pragma once. This is another way of providing header guards. So instead of defining, like, if not defined, the name of the header and then the pound define the next line saying that define and then end if at the end, you can just put pragma once. That also works. We're including a bunch of headers here. And then this is our C++ class. It's called message. It has a public interface, which is this is our the constructor. And it has this member variable called message underscore. And I don't like this kind of naming, but that exists. And it gets whatever the user passes it to it, which is a string, and assigns that value to this message. It has a friend interface. Basically, whoever is using this class, they can access this, but nobody else. That's the meaning of friend. It is overloading an operator. So the operator is the standard output string. So anytime you use standard cout or printf, this gets called. And we're basically overloading that. We're saying that we haven't seen this in C++. Sorry for the confusion or confusing example here, but let's understand how this thing works. Basically, it gets the object OS as a reference, and then the message that we want to pass. This is our message class object. And then it is going to call this print object, which is a private member in our class. And this is our member variable, and this is our member function. Now, the member function, when you call it, it is going to basically just pass that output stream, pass this thing to that output string. This is just printing that this message is nice, and it's going to print the actual message also and passes it to this output string. This is kind of a little bit overloaded for the level that we are in right now, but this is how you read this. So this is our library, basically. And after that, this is our Hello World CPP. We have this main function. It creates an object called say hello, and this is our class name, and it's going to pass this string and initialize it during the instantiation of this object, and we're going to just print that object. Basically, we call whenever you use cout, it's going to call this function to just print the whole thing here. And we're going to do another one for the say goodbye. This is another function name, and then we're going to exit with success. Now, goal is our targeted CMake that list. This is what we want to learn. So first, you have to provide the CMake minimum required version. This is not done yet. The project name and the languages that we are going to use. The libraries are the files that are being used for generating the library. It's going to have a name and a list of files that are going to be in our library. Then we're going to create an executable. We're going to name it Hello World and all the files that are going to be inside the Hello World. And then we need to link our libraries to our executable. So this is our executable object or target that we created here. And we need to link it to our library that we created here. So let's write the code, the actual code. And let's create the CPP file also. Last one is our hello world with CPP. Now, for writing our CMake file, this is what you're going to write. Step one, you're going to set the version of the CMake. So that's the version, minimum required version. The project, this is the name of the project. This is a target library that we're creating. That's the name of the project. The languages that are used in this project is C++. The library, this is the name of the library we are creating. That's our target name. This is used internally in CMake. It's not used outside of CMake. But the files that are linked to this library are these, the message, the CPP. You don't need to put the HPP files. CMake is going to ignore those. But for the, you are going to use a different command to include header files. But for the sake of brevity and make the code shorter and simpler to understand, we include it here. Then we are going to create the executable. So this is our hello world, and this is the object name, and this is the CPP file that we are going to compile into this object, hello world, that we are going to give to the user. Last step is link our library to basically our executable to our library. So this is our target executable name. So here, this is these two are the same. Now, our library name was called message, and we put it here. Now, private again means that this executable only depend this message is only the dependency of this one. They're basically hello world is going to only use the messages. Anybody else is going to, who is going to use hello world, they don't need to use the messages. So that's the meaning of that. Okay, let's put this in the CMake list.txt. If we run this, let's do CMake dash s, the new way we learned today. And we're going to put it in the build folder. CMake generation is done. And if we run make, or we run CMake dash dash build, and it's going to be in the build folder. If I go to the build folder, I see my executable here now. And if I run it, you see it executes without any problem. So we created a external library and we linked the library to our executable, and now we have our program running. So that's how you add a library in CMake. Okay, now let's get into details of CMake. CMake comes with the CMake language is kind of is called domain specific language, and it's kind of it's looks simple from the beginning. When you get into the actual code, the details of the language, it kind of gets a little bit hard to understand. So that's what we want to crack now. Okay, so when you first learn CMake, it sounds and looks pretty innocent. So the language seems very simple. It's just a bunch of commands that you call and you get the work done. So you provide your CMake required version, you give it a name, project name, and then you add your executables and done, right? That's as simple as that. And a lot of people get fooled with that, thinking that, oh, CMake is very easy. You just do this, and then you don't need to go and study it extensively. Now, that's not the case. So CMake, the syntax kind of can become a little bit hard to understand, especially if you don't have any background about the language and you don't know how to read the syntax. In this example, we are writing a function. Again, everything in CMake is a command. Even if you want to create your own function, you're going to call the function command. The name of the function is called add coverage, and it gets one argument called target. You end the function by calling another function, which is called end function, and you need these parentheses. And then here, you're looking for a program. Find program, this is a command, is looking for this lcov, looking for that, and then this is coverage. And then it's calling another program and then adding a custom target. These are the targets that you can create yourself. You can, besides the add library and create executable, you can create your own custom targets. And this is just specifying all of those. It has this weird syntax also that we haven't learned yet, and so on. It kind of gets kind of confusing. Now, the problem is if you don't know the language, you're going to just do voodoo programming, meaning that you're going to walk in the dark. You don't know what you're exactly doing. And you're going to just hope that by doing something, trial and error, and guessing things and copy and pasting from somebody else's or from like a generated chat GPT or one of these AI platforms, you're going to get the work done. You might just move forward with some steps, but you're going to get stuck at some point if you don't know what you're doing. Basically, things get so complicated that nobody else can help you unless you actually know what you're doing. So voodoo programming basically means that you're going to just try, walk in the dark, and then try to just hope that without knowing what you're doing, you hope that you can get things done. And hopefully I can help you to get out of this realm by learning CMake. And hopefully you can write the CMake the way that it has to be and understand what you're doing. So don't be a voodoo programmer. Now, when you're working with CMake, you're creating program with CMake, you are going to be basically two, you're gonna wear two hats. You're gonna be both a developer and a build engineer. So when you write a C or C++ program, you're a developer. You're gonna get a list of requirements, and you're gonna write C or C++ to get the work done. And that's all you care, right? That's a developer. Now, a build engineer, on the other hand, he or she needs to understand all the details of the compilers. That person needs to know the platforms that you're building for, the tool chains, the setup, and everything else between, right? You're building for Linux, you're building for a specific bare metal application. You have this architecture, and this is the compiler that you're going to work, all the ups and downs in the compiler and everything else. So that's how a build engineer works. Now, when you're writing CMake, you're basically going to be both, because you need to first understand the platform and the compiler and all the details of the compiler. At the same time, you're writing a programming language like a CMake. So you need to understand how CMake also works. So that's basically two positions in one role. Now, when you're writing code, it's very important to write good code, right? Writing code that functions, that's one thing, but the code that has all these features is another thing. So your code, when you're writing a code, the first thing that you target is basically your code should work. If your code doesn't work, basically it's not a code. Nobody's going to use it. So your code should work. Besides that, your code has to be easy to read. So if you write cryptic code, that's not acceptable. Your future self is going to be mad at you. Anybody who reads your code in the future is going to be mad at you. It's always good to write a code that is readable and clean and easy to understand. Next one is your code has to be easy to analyze. So don't write a code that is just like thousands of code, a line of code in the single module, and it's hard to follow along, figure out what this function does. Don't write a function that does a million things at once, and so on. So your code has to be analyzable. It has to be easy to follow and debug and understand. Now, your code has to be extendable, meaning that you never know if somebody comes back to you and tell you, okay, can you add this feature? Now, if you write all the little details of your code in the like a hard code, every single constant parameters that you have, your code is not going to be extendable because when they ask you for the new feature, you have to go and track everything and update everything manually. So your code won't be hard, would be hard to extend. The last one is maintainable. Basically, you should be able to main anybody who uses your code should be able to maintain it by writing, by running tests on your code. They should be able to extend your code if they need. So maintainability is another feature of your a good code. Code, yeah, a good code. Let me move on. Okay. Now, what you will learn from these slides are these. Basically, we are going to cover the basics of the CMake. You're going to learn about variables in CMake, CMake list, and CMake control. So basically, we are going to focus on CMake syntax. Okay, the basics of the CMake language syntax. Let's see what do we have. The first thing is, remember, everything in CMake list.txt is either a command or a comment. Nothing else. Even setting up the variables are using, we are going to use command. Creating functions is going to be done by commands. So everything in CMake list.txt is always a command. So, or a comment. Now let's get into the discussion of the comment. And you're gonna see how kind of complicated this language can become, even at the comment level. So the first type of comment in CMake is a single line comment. So you put a hash mark in front of a line, and the entire line becomes a comment. It doesn't matter if you put more hash lines, hash marks. Everything after the hash mark is going to be comment. This is similar to bash synth script and or Python. This is a comment in bash or Python. There's no slash slash like C or C++. And this is a command. Basically, message is a command that you're calling. So after a command, you can put a hash mark here. You even don't need a semicolon. So after the command, you can put a line comment after that, and that would be also valid in CMake. Now, if you want to create multi-line comment, you use this weird syntax. Basically, a hash mark, and then you put straight bracket. You can put any tokens between the other bracket, and then you close it with the again hash mark and then the same token that you started, but with the backward, the closing brackets. That's a language. So if you put any other inline comments in it, they are going to be ignored. So this is just being, this is, you cannot have nested comments inside another comment. This is going to be ignored by the language. Now, if you put two hash marks in front of the token for the multi-line, you're going to disable multi-line hash mark. Basically, this is now a single line comment. This is no longer a commented line because we disabled this by putting two hash marks. Then this would be now its own comment because this is outside of this. This is a single line now. And then this would be again another single line comment. So two hash marks in front of this token will make a multi-line comment into a single line comment. So everything in CMake is a command. To call a command, you use this syntax. Basically, the name of the command, open parentheses, and then a set of arguments that are delimited by space or semicolon, and then close parentheses. So these are called arguments. This is called command. Now, one more important thing that I mentioned, I'm going to emphasize it again. So your CMake list.txt, it has to follow this naming pattern. It has to be exactly this. Basically, capital C, capital M, make, capital L, list.txt. So CMake list, it has to be always this format. Otherwise, it is not going to be found. It's the CMake engine is not going to be able to find it. So this is an example of the just printing some messages on this screen. So project hello world, that's the name of the project. This is a minimum required version. And we're just printing these messages. Let's see an example. Let's see this in action. Okay, so I'm going to run this in CMake dash S. So the current directory dash B would be my build folder. I'm gonna just generate this CMake files. I'm not gonna build anything because I don't have anything to build. If I run that, the first step it does, it just takes care of all the compiler flags and detecting the compiler that I have on this machine, and then figuring out what is the address of that. Because I didn't provide the actual language I want for this project, it's going to assume that I'm going to have either C or C++. That's why it looked checked for both C and C++. After that's done, it's going to print the message that I asked for it. So that's the message, and it's just printing that and then saying that configuration done and generation is done. Both steps are done now. For even this simple project you see here, it generated a bunch of, again, files that are just needed for building the entire project. Okay. Now, next one is getting into the weirdness of the coded and uncoded arguments. So in CMake, when you pass an argument to the command, you can code them, putting the double quotation around the string, and that would be a single argument. Now, if you put single code around a single word and put a space between them, this would be three arguments being passed to the command. Now, a few things about the CMake commands that you might not like. I personally don't like it. One thing is that if you provide extra commands that are not required for that, extra arguments that are not required for that command, CMake is not going to yell at you, tell you this is wrong, you provided more arguments that was necessary. It's going to be kindly just ignoring them. And that can become really problematic in the future. You say, okay, I provided this this argument, but why it's not getting affected? Because maybe you have some sort of space somewhere between the arguments, or that command doesn't even require that many arguments. So CMake doesn't help you in that sense. Another thing is you provide, if you, for example, the message here is getting all these three arguments, what it does, what it's going to do behind the scene, it's going to just remove the spaces and then concatenate them into one single argument and then just print that. So it would look like this. Oops, no space, with no space. Now, you even don't need to provide quotation around the words. You can just provide them as is. So everything in CMake is string. So if you don't provide the quotations, it's going to look like this, and then CMake accepts that. But when you print that using message, there won't be any space there either. So let's see this in action. So as you can see here, we preserve the first step here, space here, as we have it here inside the quotation, but neither this one nor this one, they preserve the space they have. So without argument, without quotations, so a space gets just squished, gets removed from the string. So let's look at the command invocation. So when you want to call a command, you go just call its name and you pass arguments to it. All these arguments are separated by space, either space or semicolon. Now, few things about CMake commands. The first thing is CMake commands are not case sensitive. Basically, print underscore value is the same as capital print capital value. So CMake doesn't distinguish, doesn't make any difference between the lowercase or uppercase commands. Now you might say, okay, this is similar to VHDL, right? In VHDL, VHDL is not a case sensitive language. You can write lowercase, uppercase, it's fine. But CMake is not like that. So in CMake, commands are not case sensitive, but variables are case sensitive. Welcome to CMake, right? So that makes things very confusing. So to not confuse yourself, as a convention, always create your commands as a lowercase and use the snake case format, basically the first word underscore second word and then parentheses and so on. So always, as a convention to not confuse yourself or anybody else who reads your code, use lowercase commands with the snake case format. So this is very important, case sensitive. So commands are not case sensitive in CMake. Now, another thing, another behavior of CMake is that you CMake command invocations are not expressions. So if you have done Tickle programming, I know we have not done much in Tickle, but even in Tickle or C, you can in Tickle specifically, you can say use this command to call another command, and that command will return a value, and that get that value and pass it to the next command, basically just like opening an onion. In CMake, you cannot do that. Basically, you cannot use a command to call another command. This is what I mean. So here, the message is our command. The second message inside that is not going to be called. This whole thing is going to be considered, even the parentheses and the message, everything here is just a string. If you run this, the only thing you're going to get is just printing the message, hey, and whatever is coming after that. So you cannot use CMake command invocation to invoke or call another command. So be aware of that. So in CMake, you don't need to put semicolons at the end of the command invocation. But what you need to do is you need to always put one command on put commands on separate lines. So one command on each line. You cannot put multiple commands on the same line. So here is a fine version of the commands in CMake. So this is just a command, and this is another command. The only thing you can put after command is a comment. So you can put this comment after this command with no problem. So if you run that, you're going to see this message on the screen. Now, if you put another command after the first command, you're going to get errors. Basically, CMake is going to yell at you, telling you you cannot put two commands on the same line. Let's run this. If I run that, I get a CMake error telling me that on line 4 of the CMake list.txt, it was expecting to get a new line after the message, first message, but got another identifier, which is called a message. So you cannot do that. So always one command at a time. Now, in some cases, you want to put some text, right? Some text, some comment between the arguments. Now, what I mean is this. In C++ language, you can say, this is my int sum, and I can say int a and comma. Here, I can put a comment here, say this is the first value. And the compiler is going to just ignore that, and I can just move on from there, right? This is C++. In CMake, you can do something similar, but the syntax is kind of weird. So this is how it looks like. Here you put a hash mark, then you put two straight brackets, and then you close the two straight brackets. When you do that, that is considered an inline comment that ends here. So the rest is also included now. It's not commented out when you put it in this format. With so much in the comments in CMake. So let's run that. If I run it, I see both first argument and second argument. The reason the second argument is on the second line is because I have this backslash n, which causes the sync to go to the next program, next line. Now, in my IDE, this is kind of the IDE is confused, thinking that since I have a single hash here, it means that the rest of the line is commented out. So this IDE is kind of confused. That doesn't mean this is a single line. This is a whole, this is just up to here. This comment is up to there. Okay, Next is, besides space and semicolon, you can have next new line also. So you can have first line here, and then you can put your comment there, and then you go to the next line, and then put your second argument there, and then you can add a comment at the end of that also. So this is also a valid valid syntax in CMake. So let's see this in action again. So this is what we are doing. Basically, this is all these spaces, it doesn't matter basically. You can have the first comment here, the second comment, and these two arguments are basically in the same in the message here. So let's see this in action. Again, first argument, second argument. Now, CMake syntax seems simple, but the question is simple always good? The idea of the simple CMake was to create a simple, very simple language that you can just call commands and get things done. And that became a problem because now, what if we want to use variables? What if we want to use control flows? What if I need the if statement and so on? So how can I do that? Okay. Now let's see, look at the command arguments in CMake. So there are three ways of passing arguments in CMake, and these are the weirdness of these ways. So one way is passing arguments as a single code. The other one is passing arguments with the multiple codes with the space between them. And last one is just not putting any code between the arguments. One thing that to remember about CMake is that everything is a string. So when everything behind the scene, CMake stores everything as a string, and that's why any command that you have expects at least a zero, expects a zero or more strings being passed to it. So everything in CMake is a string. It's in that sense, it's similar to tickle. Now this is, I mentioned that this is a command and this is arguments. These are arguments we're passing to it. Now, CMake offers the three types of arguments, basically coded, uncoded, and bracket arguments. So let's see, what do I mean? So when you have a coded argument, this is similar to kind of a C++ string. You put a double quote around the string that you want to, argument that you want to pass, and that would be considered one argument. If you want to put brackets, backslash, you have to escape the backslash with the double backslash. If you want to put tab or new line or carriage return, you just put these characters. Now you're going to see that CMake coded arguments go beyond C++ strings. So in C++, so here is a similar to C++. This is also a C++ format string you see here. You're escaping this double quote here with the backslash. We're putting a new line here and so on. So this is fine. In C++, if you start a double quote and you go to the next line, this is a wrong syntax. C++ is going to yell at you, telling you you cannot, the quotation is not closed. Unless you put a escape character for the new line. But in CMake, you don't need to. So you can go to the next line and then close the quotation in the next line. So this whole thing is just part of the same argument for the message. This is just one argument being passed to the message. Also in CMake, if you want to access the value of the variable, you use this syntax, basically dollar sign curly bracket with the name of the variable close bracket. In that sense, this is similar to bash script. So this variable is called CMake version. The version was set up here in this here. And if we run this, it should, instead of printing CMake version, it's going to print 3.15 if you look at the actual output. So let's look at this in action. We'll run this. And this is how it looks like, right? So we have multi-line and we have a new line. with no problem, no warning, no error. And here we are printing the value of the variable. So to access the value of the variable, use dollar sign curly bracket. Okay, now uncoded arguments, they are delimited by either space or semicolon. So this is what I mean. So you have argument, you have here, we have three arguments because between the first one and second one, you have a semicolon here. This is a delimiter between these two arguments. And we have a space here, which is similar to that semicolon. So this is also a delimiter here. So we are passing three arguments to this command because we have these delimiters. So you can use semicolon or you can use a space. You can choose. Now, if your argument, actual argument, has semicolon in it or a space in it, you need to escape those characters. Basically, put backslash for semicolon or backslash for space to indicate that this is literally semicolon, this is literally space. Don't consider that as delimiter. So when you do that, this is going to be a single argument. Okay, I guess I'm going to stop here because we covered up to this part in the previous class. It's almost 9:45, 9:43. If you have any questions, let me know. Otherwise, I'm going to see you guys on Wednesday. We are going to continue with the rest of the CMake language, and hopefully that would hopefully that makes you just become familiar with CMake. Also, I'm going to try to provide you with some exercises that you can practice with CMake and get familiar with CMake language. Okay, guys, let's stop here, and I see you on Wednesday.
Excuse me, Professor?
Yes.
So for the, you know, mid-semester exam that we are going to have on Saturday, like what kind of questions should we expect?
Sure. Yeah, good question. So we are going to have a 30 minutes multiple choice question. It's going to be from something from 20 to 30 questions. It's going to be mainly C++ programming. And also it's going to have some questions from Git. It's going to have some questions from ARM, introduction to ARM Cortex family lecture, and also the topics that we covered during the intro lecture.
Okay.
So that's the multiple choice question exam. And after that, you're going to have the rest of the time to work on the programming exercise or exam. I'm going to provide you with the list of the software projects that you need to work, basically a requirement similar to what you had in the exorcism. So create a software program that will do X, Y, and Z. You are going to write your program. I might provide you with some tests that you can run. And then when it's done, you can run, you should be able to compile this and run it on either carrier board or on Raspberry Pi Pico. I'm going to focus on Raspberry Pi Pico because the build process on Raspberry Pi Pico is easier. So that's what we are going to do. Yep.
Okay. So for Raspberry Pi Pico, we are going to make the C++, or we're going to write the code in C++, and then we're going to run it on the Raspberry Pi, right?
Correct. Yes.
Okay. And for the submission for the Raspberry Pi Pico, it's like due on this Friday, right? So are you going to extend it or?
Oh, this. Okay. Good question. For the Canvas, yeah, I'm going to extend that one. Can you? Thank you for the reminder. So that one is not even due this week. It's not going to be due even week after. It's going to be, it's a, an on in-class exercise. It's going to be due in 2 weeks.
Oh,
you can
okay.
Start working on it, but it's not required to be done, be finished.
Yeah, week. Because that exercise involves all the, you know, dealing the stuff with the Raspberry Pi Pico.
Yep, this one is an in-class exercise or lab, so you don't need to work on it by your own. I'm going to extend that to the 2 weeks after this. Yep.
Okay, Professor.
Yep.
Thank you.
Sure, you're welcome.
Professor, one more question about the lab for part two submission of where you want that to be submitted.
Oh, sure. So submit that to the same GitHub repo. I don't think anybody actually finished that lab, so you just need to, you don't need to submit anything. Basically, just push your code to the GitHub, and if you have submitted something for the For that lab, we should be able to see your code basically on the GitHub. You don't need to submit a video demo because I didn't see anybody actually finish it.
Thank you, Professor.
Sure, you're welcome.
Have a good night.
You too, thanks.
Professor?
Yes.
I had a question regarding 524 lab.
524 lab. Okay, sure. Let me stop recording and then we discuss about that.
Okay.